So in this video, when we are talking about fixed point representation and fixed point arithmetic, we'll predominantly be talking about integer numbers, where the binary point is to the right of the LSB. Right, so we already discussed a couple of ways of representing integers. There is the unsigned representation, where we ignore all negative integers. This is commonly called the unsigned int data type in programming languages. If a value seems like it'll never be negative, then it's generally good practice to use unsigned integers. It'll give you twice the maximum representable value of a signed integer, but most of the time, it's never really about the extended range. It's more about the intent. When you declare a variable as an unsigned int, you're publishing to the reader of the code that the value will never be negative. For example, the number of samples in a buffer can't be negative. Same with the sample rate, and same with the index of an array. A negative index doesn't really make any sense. Again, it's all about the intent. It doesn't give you any added performance advantage. But you always have to be aware of arithmetic overflow. If an unsigned number does drop below zero, it'll be wrapped around to the other end of the range. If you were to take an 8-bit unsigned integer, assign it to zero, and subtract 10 from it, you'd end up getting 246, which is essentially 10 subtracted from the upper end of the range. Do the same with a 32-bit signed integer, and you get a really large value. So it's really up to the users to make sure that negative numbers don't arise from calculations with unsigned integers. Otherwise, you'll end up getting nonsensical answers. The next representation model that I hinted at was the magnitude and sign representation. One of the bits, usually the leftmost bit, is used to represent the sign of the number. And the rest of the bits are used to represent the magnitude of the number. Take the example of the number 7 in an 8-bit representation. The value in binary is 00000111. Now, according to this model, negative 7 is just flipping the leftmost bit, 10000111. Using this representation, negating a number is a really fast operation. Just flip one bit, the most significant bit. Conceptually, at least, this looks like a sound model. It's easy to visualize and understand, but implementing this in hardware is difficult. There are several problems associated with this model. One of them is the ambiguous zero problem. Consider this 8-bit number. The value represents zero, of course. Let's flip the sign bit. What is this number now? Negative zero? We know that zero is neither positive nor negative, and now we have the problem of handling two different types of zeros, one of them being redundant and ambiguous. But the main problem with this model is when binary addition is involved. The addition of two numbers isn't trivial anymore. We need to first check whether the number is negative and handle it differently if it is. Since binary addition is one of the fundamental operations a computer processor does, and since millions of such operations happen every second, this added check significantly drops the efficiency. To understand the problem, you need a tiny intro into binary addition. Consider the numbers 7 and 3 in binary. Now, binary addition is similar to decimal addition, where you add the numbers, and if there's an overflow, then you carry the excess value to the next digit. In decimal addition, 7 plus 3 is 10. And you can't really represent 10 as a single digit, so you carry the excess of 1 over to the next digit. In binary addition, it's similar, but the overflow happens when the value is greater than 1. 1 plus 1 is 10 in binary, so we retain the value 0 and carry the excess of 1 over to the next digit. 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 11. We retain 1 and carry over 1. 1 plus 1 again, retain 0, carry over 1. 1 plus 0 is just 1, so there is no overflow here. The rest of the digits remain the same, since binary addition of 0 is just 0. The resulting number, 1010 is the decimal equivalent of 10. So all good. But let's say we add 7 to negative 3. The answer is quite obviously 4, but when we implement binary addition, the value ends up being negative 10. So clearly, we need to first recognize that one of the numbers being added is a negative number. Then we need to use the binary subtraction algorithm. Then we need to figure out if the resultant number is going to be positive or negative to switch the sign bit, all the while accounting for possible overflow or underflow. This is tedious, and we want to avoid additional checks when dealing with binary addition. In other words, we want to make addition as simple as possible, irrespective of whether the numbers being added are positive or negative. To do this, we need a new representation model. Enter 2's complement. 2's complement is a binary representation model that handles negative numbers differently as opposed to just having a sign bit. The positive numbers are the same as we've seen them before. Only the negative numbers change. Let's just look at an example. Consider an 8-bit representation of the number 3. This is fair enough, we've seen this before. Negative 3 in 2's complement is this number. Right, so that's really hard to visualize and read for us humans. But as we'll soon find out, this sort of representation is computationally very efficient for computer hardware to handle. Let's take the same example as before. Add 7 and negative 3. These are the numbers, and if we were to go ahead and perform binary addition as before, we end up with this, which is the binary equivalent of 4, which is the answer we were expecting. How did we end up here? Why are we representing negative 3 this way? Computing the negative of a number, or the 2's complement of a number, is a two-step process. First, you take the 1's complement of the number. 1's complement is just a fancy way of saying flip all the bits of the number. If a bit was previously 0, it becomes 1. And if it was previously 1, it becomes 0. Essentially, a bitwise negation operation. The second step is to add 1 to the result. There you go, that's it. If we take the 2's complement of this number again, we end up with the original. So it's clearly a reversible operation. But why? Why do we represent numbers this way? How do we build our intuition to work with 2's complement representation? The really simple motivation behind this is when you add a number with its negative, the result should be 0. If we can force this to happen, our representation model should be able to handle a wide variety of cases. How do we force this to happen? If you take any n-bit number and then add it with its 1's complement, you'll end up with the largest number that n bits can represent. What if we add 1 to this? We get an overflow. 8 bits can no longer hold this value. The number resets to 0, and the overflow that's supposed to go to the 9th bit is discarded since there is no memory available for the 9th bit. Simply put, any n-bit number added to the 1's complement plus 1 of the same number is 0. It's the same equation as before. Any number added to the negative of the same number is 0. So we can treat the 1's complement plus 1 as the negative number of the original. Another simple way of looking at 2's complement numbers is to visualize the rotary dials of a slot machine or the odometer of a car. What happens when you reverse the spindle and the gears of these dials manually below 0? In the case of a car's odometer, nothing really happens if you've seen Ferris Bueller's Day Out. Reversing a car doesn't actually reverse the odometer gauge. But let's just say, hypothetically, it does. The resulting number is all 9s, the largest possible number, and it reduces from there on out. Now consider the same rotary dials, but with binary numbers instead. One rotation below 0 results in all 1s which we term as negative 1 in 2's complement. Negative 2 is one rotation below that. Negative 3 is one more rotation below that, and so on. As long as the most significant bit is 1, the number is negative. Once the most significant digit is flipped to 0, the numbers are positive and follow the familiar logic that's easy for us to understand. With 2's complement representation, you also avoid the ambiguous 0 problem. 2's complement of 0 is 0 itself, so you don't have to worry about a redundant 0 that we saw with the sine and magnitude representation. Another nice quirk about the 2's complement model is that if we need to extend the width of a register that's holding the value, let's say from 8 bits to 16 bits, all we need to do is pad the extended register bits with the most significant bit of the number. This way, the extra bits when expanding the storage of the register from 8 bits to 16 bits is padded with zeros for positive numbers and ones for negative numbers. The original value is still retained. A final thing to note is that 2's complement is the predominantly used sign notation for binary numbers. Unless otherwise stated, you can always assume that when dealing with signed integers in a computer, the underlying binary representation is always 2's complement.